Knowledge for Men, episode 19.
Welcome to knowledgeformen.com, where boys turn into men, where men turn into leaders, into lions, the ferocious few who stand strong, a place where you grow to become the man you were born to be. It's time to take massive action towards the life you want. Get the health, get the relationships, business, and career you've always dreamed of. Achieve a level of success and happiness that you've been searching for so many years. Life has given you enough, and it's time to take a stand and take full control of your life. Stand with us as we interview the most inspiring and successful leaders to give you real-world advice to crush life and awaken the sleeping giant inside of you. Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible.com. Get a free audiobook download today at kfmbook.com. There's over 100,000 titles to choose from for your smartphone, tablet, or computer. It's a perfect way to listen to your favorite books in the car, in the gym, or at home. Check out kfmbook.com to start learning in your downtime.
All right, guys, welcome to the show. I'm here with Oliver Emberton, the founder of Silktide, a pianist, programmer, and artist. He writes about getting the most out of life, and he's been published on Forbes, Huffington Post, Lifehacker, and many more major publications. He's also working on a novel because the internet told him to. We'll have to jump into that later. Oliver, I'm happy to have you on the show.
Thank you, Andrew. It's an honor to be here.
All right, let's dive into your favorite success quote and why.
Okay, well, I'm going to go with something a little unusual. A person's success in life can usually be measured by the number of uncomfortable conversations they're willing to have. And that comes from Tim Ferriss. I like it because it's not the obvious. It's not what you're expecting to hear. And it's very true in my experience. People hold themselves back from success simply because they're unwilling to try something uncomfortable.
Yeah, that can be with relationships, a significant other, business relationships. Just so much about getting what you want in life has to do with communicating what you want so other people are aware and they know where you stand. And those uncomfortable conversations are really about fear of the unknown, uncertainty, and your ability to handle potential conflict. So having these difficult conversations ensures that your voice is heard and you're not being walked over.
Absolutely.
All right, Oliver, let's jump into your story now. How did you get started with what you do? Share with the audience your story.
Okay, well, 12 years ago, I was an impoverished student set to graduate with about $20,000 of debt and not a clue what to do. And so I did what any sensible person would do, and I started my own business. I really didn't know what I was doing. I knew I always wanted to start my own business. I found someone who I didn't really know very well who offered to co-found with me. This turned out to be less than a brilliant decision when at our second board meeting, he punched me in the face.
What? Oh my God.
He provided $5,000 of startup capital, which at the time sounded amazing, but of course now I know was hilariously inadequate. And we basically bounced around from failure to failure, struggling pretty much just to put food on the table for the first year or so. I had everyone from my friends and my family come to me and say, really, what are you doing? Are you an idiot? And they may well have been right, but I persisted. I started off and I was what you might call charitably an ultra nerd. I was one of those guys, I couldn't talk to anyone. I had no self-confidence whatsoever. And the reason I partnered with the guy I partnered with, he claimed to be a masterful sales director, but unfortunately, he really had no clue what he was doing. We were at the time a web design company and we were pitching to some quite impressive names at the beginning. And he would start a meeting by saying something like, I have to be honest, I don't really know how to use email. I'm not much of a techie. And I'm like, we're a tech company. What are you doing? He was absolutely appalling. So I found myself in a situation where the only way I could feed myself was to learn how to sell. So I just had to. I studied. I found books. I just went on what was called the internet back then, which barely even had a YouTube. And I worked at it like crazy. And in a weird way, because I had to do this, I could do this. There was no choice. I mean, I was surviving off donated tins of food from my friends. Our first year, we made a profit of £200, which is about enough to buy one iPod Touch. Everything we could have done wrong, we did wrong in that first year. But I learned everything that allowed me to go forward into what would later become very successful. I realized that I could actually sell. I realized that even though I didn't have this crazy confidence of this other guy, that I actually knew what I was talking about. And I knew that ultimately was more important. And I freed myself of this person. I bought him out for the exact same amount of money he gave me in the first place, a mere $5,000. And it turned out, yeah, well, let's just say that 12 years later, the company's worth a little bit more than that. So,
okay, let's get this straight. You had a partner who would punch you, and then you were really on your own on this business. So you had your back against the wall, clearly. And you were forced to either learn how to sell and make this business work, or you wouldn't eat. And with time, you were able to make enough money to buy your sucker-punching business partner out. So, Oliver, when did you have the major aha moment or tipping point when things started to really turn from bad to good?
I have to be honest, I think when I was 20, 21, I didn't realize this, but it's obvious to me now. Almost every problem you have, someone else has had before. Every single one, right? If you think you're struggling with a relationship or you don't know how to sell or whatever it is, right? Pretty much everything has already been answered for you. And most of the time it's been answered in books or on the internet. And if you're just willing to look for it, you'd be amazed. You can find the answer to just about everything. For me, the killer thing was I started studying how people thought. I started studying how our psychology works. And that was something that I guess school doesn't teach you this. But for me, it was absolutely crucial because I suddenly realized I could understand people in a way that they didn't even realize. I like a quote by Felix Dennis. He says, and he's a self-made billionaire, and he likes to say, my one and only skill is that I know what everyone wants 2 minutes before they do, which I love that. And it's true. There's huge power in just understanding the fundamentals of the human mind. And so armed with that basic knowledge and also appreciation of your own weaknesses as well, appreciation of why, for example, we procrastinate or why we struggle, we wrestle with our inner demons or what have you. But coming to understand those things really empowers you to actually do something about and transform your life. That was the big thing for me.
I like that. All problems have already been experienced and answered for you through other people in history. And there's 7 billion people. So look for books, look on the internet, and you're going to find an answer to the problem you already have. But the first step there is you got to acknowledge that you have a problem. And for so many people, they can't do that. Then from there, search for help. I love books. Because somebody spent their entire life or half their life learning some great lesson, and they put it in this easy format with chapters, it's organized, and you can just learn it in 1 week. And we all know that books have a lot of the answers, but you still have to endure through the tough times. On your journey, Oliver, can you share with the audience a time when you encountered a failure or challenge, and how did you overcome that?
Well, as you say, I pretty much did everything wrong, so that would be a very long podcast, but I mean...
Yeah, we could do the entire podcast on your failure, maybe?
That sounds quite entertaining. I think my girlfriend would love that one. No, there were lots of things I failed. I mean, I hired bad people at times. I made bad deals. There's loads of things I could focus on. Like I said, my business partner was appalling, right? I mean, literally, I'm talking, I owed 50% of everything I made to a guy who, it turns out, used to basically punch people because he disagreed with them, right? I'm not kidding. The guy was literally unstable. And you might think, how can you recover from that? But the reality is the things I got wrong didn't really matter. And I think this is a mistake people make, right? They go like, oh, I've made this mistake or I might make this mistake. How will I ever recover? Truth is, it doesn't really matter. As long as the failure doesn't kill you, get past it. It's the successes that make all the difference. You can make 1,000 terrible, terrible songs, but if you make one hit song, you're made. That's it. And people don't think like that. They think, I have to make a hit song. So they're afraid to make the rubbish song in the first place. So my experience is, I mean, you can talk about how you get past the bad moments. I don't really think it's about fixing those. You identify, okay, something went wrong. What can I learn from it? And you move past it. And that's it.
Live and learn. Take the lessons with you because that is your personal growth. That's it. Those lessons, those failures, that's your growth. Oh, and you actually have a viral blog article titled How to Master Your Life. I think this really resonates with what we're talking about here. Can you share with the listeners some of the lessons and the key takeaways from that blog post?
Okay, so I wrote a quite successful post called How to Master Your Life. This got at least 500,000 people read this one. So this is what basically I say, that mastering your life is a little bit like playing a game, The Sims. I don't know if you've ever tried this, but it's a mouse-controlled game where you move your character or characters around a simulation of real life. And the idea of the game is really simple. You just tell your characters what to do. Go to work, you buy a new house, dead easy. It's exactly like real life, except for one key difference, which is that your characters do exactly what you want them to. There's no barrier between what you want to do and what you do. If you want to go up to that girl and talk to her and say hello, you will just do it. In real life, it's exactly the same, of course, except we seem to be getting in the way almost of our own mouse pointers. We're unable to commit to the actions that we choose, even when we know what we should be doing. If you look at something like someone trying to get fit, right? So if you were playing The Sims and you want your character to get fit, it's really obvious. You go, you pick your character and you say, put some trainers on, go outside, go for a run. Or if you can afford it, you go to a gym or whatever, right? It's a no-brainer. There's no question involved. But in reality, what we do is we're like, oh, I want to get fit. Yeah, that's difficult. Maybe I should get a magazine on that and I'll read the magazine and then I'll go and I'll Google for lots of Twitter accounts I should follow. And then maybe if I follow enough of the right Twitter accounts, I'll get inspired enough to choose the gym I need to maybe work out the schedule I should plan to start getting fit. And it's just ridiculous. We know what we should do, but our own brains get in the way. And kind of the moral of that particular post is that you should just go ahead and click something. You should just, you know, get away from that barrier and just get in the habit of going, okay, I know what to do, now act. Don't delay, don't think, don't make some big elaborate dance about it. You can just go ahead and click something.
Yes, take action, get results. That is all that matters. People can handcuff themselves to a problem and just never break free. Stop thinking, start doing. Overwhelm your mind with action. Just go, get it done. Stop thinking, stop looking for reviews, stop asking for opinions, and just make up your mind and go. Do what you need to do, get it done. So Oliver, what advice do you have for the listeners to help them take more action and break through and overcome those mental barriers?
Okay, well, there's a few things. So do you know there's a big difference? We've all experienced this, where sometimes you have a really rubbish moment, a moment where, I don't know, maybe you have an argument with someone and you're like, oh God, what did I do? I was a total moron. You know, I cannot believe I said that. Maybe you went on a podcast and you made a total fool of yourself, for example.
Happens all the time, Oliver.
But there are moments when you're like, you can't even look at your own actions and think, what was I thinking? But then there are other moments when you walk away and you're like, oh yeah, I was amazing. Check me out. How great was that? And we all have this. We have these moments, but there's a pattern. There's a reason why we have that. And the one of the biggest ones is your state, basically. I mean, this is a Tony Robbins thing that's been going around for years, but it's very powerful for me. It's if you are in a bad state. So like in The Sims, if your character is like desperately hungry and he needs the toilet, and he's jumping up and down, incredibly frustrated, hasn't spoken to a friend in years, whatever, he's going to be in a terrible state. He's going to perform badly. You're going to say, go ahead and talk to that girl, and he's either going to make an idiot of himself because he's just not in a very good mind, or he's going to refuse to do it outright. He's going to be terrified. On the other hand, if you're rested, if you've had, I don't know, a little bit of exercise maybe, and you've ate well and so on, you're elevating your state. You make it that much easier to go ahead and do something and to do a good job of it when you try.
Make your move. If you've been to a Tony Robbins event, you would understand that. And by the way, I have the best move. So changing your state lifts your confidence, your energy into something more positive that you can move forward with. Examples of state changing is mainly going to be changing your physiology. So you're feeling sad, go to the gym, eat something good. You're nervous about an interview, shout out, I don't know, as loud as you can, I'm the king of the world. I mean, that would definitely change your state, wouldn't it? Especially if you're full on and congruent with it and people are looking at you. You're going to feel, you're going to have a lot more energy. The point is you can control your state. Don't let your state control you. And with a positive, confident, energetic state, you're in a good position to take some good action and make some good moves in your life. So, for example, if you see a girl you like, just smack your hands together and tell yourself, I got this. Everything's under control. And go talk to her. Don't go buy a book on how to talk to girls or call a friend like, hey, how do I do this? Or join a forum and ask other guys who are on this forum, which means they don't know what they're doing either, what to do. You just go do it. Take action, learn, go.
I agree, but I will say one thing. If you say you want to talk to girls or you want to do your business or whatever, there is a lot of value in reading. There is, right? But what people do is they get it the wrong way around. They think, I need to master this skill and then I'll try it. So it's a bit like saying, you know what? I really want to be a guitar player. So I'm going to read 50 books on the guitar and then I'm going to go buy a guitar. Now, that's stupid. But at the same time, if you do buy a guitar, it does make sense to go and study it. You got to work hard at it. So I'd say if you're looking to, whether you're looking to find a particular woman or your business or whatever you're looking to do, it is worth doing that study. It's just don't make that an excuse to do anything. Make it something that makes what you do stronger.
Yeah, there's the saying, knowledge is power, but even more powerful is applied knowledge. And when you do this, I believe you can truly achieve greatness.
Absolutely.
And Oliver, you have an equally popular blog post titled Finding Extraordinary Success and Fulfillment in Life.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this would really resonate with all the listeners here. Can you go ahead and share with the audience some of the key lessons in there?
Okay, yeah, great. So this is a common issue most people have. So they hear a series of lies about how they should succeed in their life. They hear things like hard work will make you successful, which is nonsense. I mean, it helps, but it doesn't make you successful. Clearly, there are lots of very hardworking people out there who are not remotely successful. We also hear people going and saying things like, you should do what you love. And they say, well, that's great. I should do what I love. Fantastic. Why am I unemployed and poor? So this article was really about bringing all these things together and trying to tell you how you can find that kind of moment of personal fulfillment and success, but all, so that you're actually rewarded for what you love doing. And yeah, it's kind of like solving that holy trinity, if you will, what you could be paid to do, what we're great at, and what we love to do. Basically, there are three things you can aim for in your work, right? You can aim for work that you're good at, work that you love, and work you can be paid for. And the real success, the extraordinary success, comes from people who absolutely will not settle for all three. Now, this is a very easy thing to say, but almost nobody ever does it. So let me elaborate a little bit, right? So most people, they settle for work that they're good at and work they can be paid for. They do that because they follow, you know, their skills, and obviously they have to kind of earn a living, so that's fine, right? But some people go for work that they love, but they can't be paid for. Occasionally, you see them generally starving on the street or struggling to busk for a living or whatever. It's incredibly hard for a lot of people to imagine that this actually exists. But it's usually, in my experience, it's just down to refusing to accept anything less. It's a bit like, maybe you've seen someone like this with who looks for a partner. Have you ever met someone who's really picky when they look for a partner? And you're kind of like, wow, I can't, is that person going to be single forever? You're not sure. But they tend to have a habit of actually getting what they want because they refuse to settle for less. They're actually, it's a surprisingly effective strategy. Most people are too afraid. They're too quick to settle for the first job that comes their way, and then they're too afraid to maybe make a leap away from it to look for something better. So they stay with the first thing they find, and then they move maybe a little inch forward here and there. And they never find that incredible trinity where you've got something you're good at, you love, and that you're paid for. The reason why it's so powerful is because when you've got that work that you love, it gives you basically infinite energy. If you imagine waking up in the morning and you are working on exactly what you want to do, right? You are like, I'm kind of living the dream. It's brilliant, right? So that gives you incredible drive and energy. Like if I have a crap day, it doesn't even matter. I mean, it sucks for like 10 minutes, but it doesn't matter. I know I get to go back and do basically what I want to do. And because I do that and I've worked at it for so long, the rewards compound out of that process. Because when you love to do something and you're good at it, you get fantastically good at it. The two feed off each other and the reward just spirals out of control over time. Now, like I said, another thing I brought up in this article, which I think is really powerful and really important, is that if you think success will make you happy, you have it backwards. So many people look at success and they're like, I have to get successful and then I'll be happy. And in my experience, it goes back a little bit to what I said about state earlier. If you are happier, you will become successful. The people who are really depressed and are beating themselves up all the time and like, oh, I can't make anything work and whatever, those people are not in a good state to succeed. They're going to really struggle. And they're looking at it backwards. They're like chasing up the mountain for their entire life, thinking that it'll find them happiness. And really, they need to find that before they start. They need to be working on something they enjoy and then compounding that into the success, not chasing the money and hoping that will make them happy afterwards.
Great points. If you are happier, you will become successful versus chasing money then thinking, once I get it, oh, now it's time for me to be happy. Happiness is something you already have or find on your journey, not something that instantly comes to you when you become successful. Oliver, what would you say to the people, I know they're thinking this, but the people who know that they don't like their work, they're not passionate about what they do, but they need to keep that job to keep them afloat. They have a mortgage to pay rent. They have children, or they need it for health insurance, or they have dependents.
Okay.
What would you suggest for them to do?
Okay. It's definitely easier when you're younger. I'll give you that. I was lucky that I was young and stupid enough to not even think about it, which it turns out was a kind of blessing. One of the big things people mistake is they look at what they love doing and they think, I can't see a way to do that. The way that normally works is they're looking for a pre-packaged solution. So say you're like really good, I don't know, tennis or something, and you're like, you really want to be this amazing tennis instructor or whatever, but you want to be more, you want to be like this celebrity tennis instructor. You can't find a job for that. You can't go and apply for that. You have to make that yourself. And if you look at the people who are really successful, whether they be, I don't know, a Will Smith or a Bill Gates or whatever, they didn't go and apply for a standard job. They made their job. They decided what they wanted to be, and maybe they didn't get it right at first, but they worked at it and they kept kicking at that tire until they managed to get to what they wanted. Again, if you're looking for a standard off-the-shelf solution, that's what most people do. That's what most people settle for. It's called a job, and it's generally, it's not the best way to find happiness in your working life, especially.
So you're suggesting for these folks to stop looking for some sort of cookie-cutter perfect job and start slowly creating the job you want. Decide what you want to be, work at it, be persistent. And honestly, my take is you can work a job you don't like, but you know, you still have from 6 p.m. till midnight. So you get off work at 4:30, come home, eat, take a nap, whatever. And then you have the weekends too. So you have from 6 p.m. to midnight, and then you have the weekends to really put in work on something you're truly passionate about. It won't even seem like work when you're doing something you're meant to do. That's really the point. In fact, previously, when I first started doing this Knowledge for Men thing, at my day job, I couldn't wait until I got off work to start doing what I really wanted to do, which was this.
It's not necessarily the end of the world if someone wants to be an employee, of course, right? But I think most of the people who are listening to your podcast are not those people. I think they're looking for something more. And if you're looking for something more, you will not find it by exchanging your hours for money. That will never work. You need to get out of that trap. And in fact, a lot of people who start a business make that mistake still. So they're like, hey, I want to be a freelance designer or whatever. And then what they do is they just start selling their hours in the same way as they would for as an employee, right? So then they're in the same trap as they would be, except without the security, maybe slightly more money. And they usually wake up 10 years later and go, what happened? aren't I meant to be like an entrepreneur and really successful? I know I had that problem myself. That was kind of the story I probably should have started with. My business was really successful for 10 years, and then I gave it up because it wasn't what I wanted to do. I got to this funny point where I'd spent 10 years convincing the world that actually maybe I wasn't an idiot and becoming reasonably good at what I was doing. And we had like the largest web agency in the whole area that I'm in. We were doing great stuff, but I wasn't happy. It wasn't what I wanted to do. I'd ironically built a business doing something I didn't enjoy. And one of the biggest, most transformative moments of my life is I chose to give that up. I'd spent 10 years building a business and I gave it up in order to build what I really wanted to do. And now that was quite a gamble. And as it turns out, a lot of people weren't particularly happy with that gamble, but it paid off hugely. We trebled in size in our first year. We trebled in size in the second, and we're in the middle currently of the next one. And a lot of exciting things are happening with us right now. So to those who think it can't be done, almost invariably, they're the ones who have never even tried.
Yeah, it's those negative naysayers that talk the most and are so quick to say that it can't be done. Probably because it's going to be really, really hard to get something going and to really build something of your own. It is challenging. Especially at first, it's scary, daunting, and you're really uncertain about the future. However, it can be done, and you will learn so much in this process. So, Oliver, what are some of the biggest lessons and takeaways you have learned with starting your company?
Well, obviously, picking the right partner helps. And actually, no, seriously, one of the things about picking a partner, it's not so much getting the right person. It definitely does help. You can't know everything that they're going to do right or wrong. It's about making sure you understand what happens if something goes wrong. So like, make sure you've got an exit strategy. Make sure you know if you're working with someone and it isn't working out, you've got an agreed way to just set them free. But I think the biggest thing I learned was if you do something big, it's hard to fail completely. So what I mean is, okay, this applies for a business. This applies for writing a novel, which is something else I'm doing right now. This applies to any crazy endeavor you can think of. If you are ambitious in your goal, if you do something slightly insane, like you're 21 and you don't know what you're doing and you go, I'm going to start a business, there's a good chance that you'll fail, but you probably won't fail completely. Like, by many people's standards, my first year, I had kind of technically failed. I mean, we were still in business, but we weren't making any money. I was barely able to feed or dress myself. It took several years before we got to a comfortable position. But in reality, even though I was failing, I was actually developing a huge range of skills that would ultimately allow me to succeed. It's the same, like, were I to write my first novel and it turns out it's a disaster and that four people read it and two of them are my parents, then I still will have learned an absolute ton from putting like a year plus into writing. Just think how much better my writing will be or how much of a better understanding I'll have of what makes a successful book. So whatever you do, I would say if your ambitions are high, you can't actually really fail that badly. You may not succeed as wildly as you expect, but you'll find yourself growing faster than you would imagine.
So picking the right partner and to go big, because it's hard to fail completely when you're going so big. And even if you don't hit your personal goal, you're still making significant strides and you're learning so much in your own personal and professional life when you do. And they say the wealthiest place in the world is actually the graveyard, because that's where men's dreams, passions, ideas went undone or unfinished. So don't let that happen. You won't know how far you can go unless you're willing to consistently raise the bar.
Absolutely. And you know what? There's some interesting things about that as well. If you aim high, you've got Robbins, I think, calls a big, audacious, hairy goal. I think that's what he calls it. If you've got a crazy objective, something amazing, that's really energizing. That's really exciting. You're like, today I get to do this. I'm going to land a man on the moon or something, right? No, that gets people excited. But you know what doesn't get people excited? When they've got these kind of mediocre goals and they're like, yeah, today I'm going to arrange some paper. It just doesn't get you going in the same way. So do the crazy thing, try the crazy thing. Maybe you screw up, but you're almost certainly going to get closer to where you want to be. And really, the cost of failure nowadays isn't that great. People just get terrified because they think, oh no, what if my business fails? Well, what if your business fails? Who cares? Do another one. There's plenty of people who had 10 failed businesses before they made an 11th that worked. But if you want to sit there and be comfortable your whole life, you're never going to find that. You're never going to find that moment.
And what advice do you have for the guys out there who are uncomfortable right now? They're onto something big. They're working really hard, yet they're not seeing significant results. And they're fighting to make rent and feed themselves every month.
I have to be honest, there's a saying here, and people won't like to hear it, but when something succeeds, usually 90% of the time, it starts off doing reasonably well. What I mean by that is, like, if you're doing the right thing, you usually don't find you have to push too hard to make it work. However, you may think this sounds backwards because I spent, you know, years struggling, as many do. That doesn't mean you don't have to work hard at first. It's just what you're trying to do is find that thing. You're trying to find what makes you successful. So, for example, if you've got a bad idea and you're pushing that up the hill and you're like trying to meet people and they all think it's terrible, it might well be worth considering trying other ideas, or at least refining the idea or obtaining the right level of feedback or understanding that might come help you see it in a different light. Because you do have to be tenacious. You have to be willing. Like, I knew that I always wanted to be an entrepreneur. I knew I really wanted a business. But the way I started, I mean, I did everything wrong. And I mean everything, right? I mean, I partnered with a complete muppet, to use the technical term. I didn't know how to sell. I underpriced things. I sold the wrong things. That's all fine. It's fine because you're doing that and you're learning as you do it what works. I like to think of it a bit like tuning a radio. You're kind of, most of the time you're dialing through static. Sorry, this is like an old radio, you know, back in the, what is it, 90s or something. But when you're tuning a radio and you just get noise, and then you kind of pick up a hint of a signal and you hear something and you're like, oh, hold on a second. And then you tune that dial and you just try and refine it until you get a nice, clear signal. And life can be a lot like that. You spend a lot of time just tuning through noise and you're thinking, nothing's working, this is a disaster. And then you get that hint of a signal and you just have to hone down on that like crazy. So I always find, don't be afraid to quit the wrong things. Don't be afraid to kind of move on a bit and try. But as soon as you get that signal, as soon as you find some positive encouragement, then you really want to focus on that. You really want to go crazy.
So try new things. Don't be afraid to move on if it's not working. It's not failure. You didn't fail. If you move on to something else, just take the lesson and make your next project even better, 10 times better, because you have the lesson. And actually, all of that can be applied to relationships as well. You know, never settle. Keep moving if you have to.
Absolutely. You know, there's a saying, they always say winners never quit, right? I think that's absolute crap. I think winners quit all the time. They just quit the right things. There's this stigma attached. In fact, generally, if there's a stigma attached to anything, you should always be wary of the stigma. But like with quitting, people tell themselves, no, I absolutely can't give up. Well, no, maybe you don't give up. Maybe you just try something else. You can be a successful business person. Just refine your idea or possibly consider, is it actually the right one?
Just like in relationships, if it's not working, you need to move on. You break up from that person or that idea in a business because you know there are millions of other people out there for you in a relationship. Or hopefully you know this, you break up and move on if it's not working. But in business, I feel like there's a stigma to persistence and never giving up. There's so many books out there, there's videos out there, seminars, there's guys saying this. You're just so close, keep going. And I personally think you can always keep going, but maybe try some new things and see what works out.
The trouble is, it can be addictive. You can get into this mindset of like, I am absolutely never going to quit. I absolutely must make this work. And you can do that, like you said, with a relationship just as much as you can do it with a business. It's because you refuse to accept the possibility that you could be wrong. And I always think that's dangerous. Something else I've learned in life is you should always be willing to accept the possibility that you are wrong, even that your like most diehard beliefs could be flawed. Because the truth is, we all do and say and think incredibly stupid things at times, and we're always blind to it. Have you ever seen a person who you know they're wrong, right? They're defending the indefensible. They have this belief, whatever it may be, and there's no point arguing with them because they already know that they're right, even though they are so desperately wrong.
Yeah, that's ignorance. And when that happens, you're not seeing reality for what it is. However, I will say there are some benefits to that. Oliver, we have now entered the knowledge round. Are you ready?
Let's go.
For you, the listeners of the Knowledge for Men podcast, Audible is offering a free audiobook download with a free 30-day trial to give you the opportunity to check out their awesome service. And you know what? Something I've noticed after interviewing hundreds of successful people is that they all read a ton of books. If you want to be successful, you've got to educate yourself every day. I don't always have time to sit down and read a book, so I personally recommend listening to audiobooks in your car, in the gym, or on the go. You can pick up for free any one of my favorite best-selling books like Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill, How to Get Rich by Felix Dennis, Rich Dad Poor Dad by Robert Kiyosaki, The Education of Millionaires by Michael Ellisberg, The Millionaire Fast Lane by MJ DeMarco, or any other audiobook you want. Audible has over 100,000 titles. To download your free audiobook today, go to kfmbook.com. Again, that's kfmbook.com for your free audiobook today. Start learning, growing, and becoming the man you want to become now. Welcome to the Knowledge Round, where the guests will be asked rapid-fire questions to give the audience invaluable pieces of wisdom to help transform their lives. Starting in 3, 2, 1, showtime.
Oliver, how would you explain being an entrepreneur to a newcomer?
Okay, so all an entrepreneur is someone who figures out how to make money. And in fact, specifically, they make a machine that makes money. It sounds really, really simple, like anyone can do it. But very few people actually think of it like this, right? So just imagine you're building something that takes in, I don't know, your time, your energy, money, and it converts it into more. That's it. And if you can build a good machine, you've got a machine that can take in money, feed it back into itself, and it can grow forever. Almost no one ever builds such a thing. But that's all there is to it. People seem to think that they need a PhD in business or something. It's not true. It's really just about making a machine that turns effort and money into more money.
And Oliver, what is the most important skill that has helped you succeed in your business venture?
Self-control. I would say when you come to realize that we're all really kind of flawed in the same stupid ways. I mean, like, everyone's willpower fails, everyone gets tired or lazy, or they make mistakes or they forget things. As soon as you realize this and you choose not to deny that, but to work with it, to kind of face it, you can master it, you can control it.
All right. Oliver, what was holding you back from becoming the successful entrepreneur that you are today?
I would say courage at first. I was lucky that I kind of made an accidentally brave decision at the beginning. I knew what I wanted to do, but I was kind of lucky in that I was stupid and ignorant enough to do it anyway. That helped. But later on, it took time to kind of find that strength internally and to really do things. Like I said, like giving up a business I'd spent 10 years building in order to gamble it on a new one, that made all the difference.
Well said. What's the best advice you've ever received from a mentor?
I would say put your time where your heart is. I would say that most people make this mistake, right? That they love something, right? And maybe they work on it for a bit while they're a kid or whatever, but then they get later on in their life and they find that they never spend any time on it. They spend all their time going to work, or they spend all their time doing the obligations for other people. If you are spending most of your time, however you do that, spending most of your time on what you love doing, you will find a way to make that better. You will find a way to prosper from it, to make it more successful. So I'd say that is the single most important thing I could possibly say, is put your time where your heart is and you will find that success will come to you afterwards.
Oliver, I know this next question is going to be challenging, but what are the three most influential books that you have ever read?
Okay, well, this one is, it's, as you say, very difficult. I'm going to go with How the Mind Works by Steven Pinker. This is one of the most inspiring books I ever read when I was fairly young. It explains the basics of evolutionary psychology. It's very clear and easy to understand. You don't need a science background or anything. But by the end of it, I felt I understood humanity in a whole different way entirely. I cannot recommend it highly enough. It's actually quite old. I'm sure it's still in print, but yeah, it's not very commonly cited, but it's definitely worth a read. And it also is great at cocktail parties because you can always excite people by explaining why we like art or have a sense of humor. So my next book is a classic I'm sure everyone has heard of, but I cannot recommend enough either. And that would be The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. If there's one self-help book that I give out more than any other, it's definitely this one. I must have given out about 30 or 40 copies easily. I still read it every now and then. It's incredibly powerful and incredibly dense. The thing I would say is people can make the mistake of trying to read the whole thing. Seriously, just read the first 1, 2, 3 habits. That's it. If you can master even the first 2 or 3, you're ahead of 99% on the planet. It's incredibly powerful if you actually choose to apply it. And the third book is something very recent, which is Scott Adams. You may know him as the artist behind Dilbert. Wrote a self-help book of all things, and it's called How to Fail at Almost Anything and Still Win Big. And it's occasionally it is hilarious, but it's incredibly powerful, very countercultural. It will tell you all sorts of things like stop chasing your goals, forget goals, which a lot of people here may struggle with. You want to be looking at systems. It will tell you reasons why this kind of chasing your one great skill that you can be brilliant at is probably not actually a good idea, and why you may be better off developing a whole raft of skills. And generally, it's just kind of amazing. I really can't recommend it enough.
And I know how much you guys love audio, so I have partnered with Audible, and you can pick up one of these books in audiobook format if you go to kfmbook.com. Get a free audiobook download today. And okay, real quick, you're going to have to break it down a little bit about why not setting goals is good. Go ahead.
Sure. Okay. So the basic idea is that we can get addicted to setting goals, and you can, the problem with the goal is you're unhappy the whole time that you're not hitting the goal, kind of. So you set this crazy goal, like I'm going to get super, super fit and I'm going to run an ultra marathon. And then if you fail to do that, you kind of feel like crap. And then the problem is you've done your goal and then you're like, okay, I did my goal. Yay, I'm happy for 10 minutes. Now let me set another goal. Now, what he proposes is instead setting a system. So a system might be something like I'm going to exercise X hours a week or whatever. Now, you might pass through goals in the process, but it's actually much more efficient in many ways to it's certainly it's a lot easier to be happy to focus on procedures that get you to a state rather than to focus on just the end in mind. So as an example, make sure you write 1,000 words every week or 1,000 words every day. Do that and you'll be amazed what happens. Forget I'm going to write the book for now. Just start writing 1,000 words. You'd be amazed how often that simple little habit ultimately becomes something far more powerful than the goal you were aiming for.
That's really interesting. I'm going to have to look more into that. And Oliver, what's one action one person can take right now that would get them closer towards their dreams?
I would say close the gap. And what I mean by that is people can think too much. They can overthink how they're going to get to whatever they're trying to get to so much that they can paralyze themselves. And I like to think of this as just, okay, you know what? I want to say I want to talk to that girl. Don't tell my girlfriend this. Say I want to talk to that girl. And so what do? I close the gap. I just walk up to her. That's a start, right? It's not much. It's a simple thing. And then I have to talk to her. I'm a little bit closer to my goal. I want to start a business. Okay, just move in that direction. Find someone who's done it and talk to them. Or write a plan or anything. Take a step. But get into the habit of taking steps regularly, and don't be afraid if the steps you take are wrong. People can overthink this. They can sit down and write a 300-page plan. I must get fit. Here's my 20-page guide. I must build my business. Here's my 50-page guide. And very few people, even if they're Richard Branson, actually did any of that. They just kind of, you know, they started being an entrepreneur. John Lennon, I'm sure at one point, he just picked up a guitar. He didn't go, how do I become the Beatles? So I would just say, close the gap. Find where you're at. Find where you want to go. Try and reduce the distance. And just keep doing that. And you'd be amazed how far you get.
All right, Oliver, I have a scenario for you. Imagine you woke up and you were 20 years old again. You know everything you know now. You have a laptop and $1,000. What would you do?
Okay, well, the money, the $1,000 doesn't really matter because, to be honest, if you got $1,000 or a relatively small amount of money, all you're going to use that for is to stay alive, right? So let's not worry about the money. What matters is what you do with your time, especially when you're 20 years old. That's the powerful thing. That is your asset, because when you're 20, you got lots of it. And when you're, I don't know, 90, not so much. So the first thing I'd do, I'd throw myself into things that excite me. So let's assume I didn't necessarily know exactly what I was going to do. I didn't have my plan to build the next Facebook or whatever. I know I want to do something. I would find stuff that excites me and I would throw myself into it. And I mean like full immersion. I'm going to do this. I'm going to really enjoy it. And if it turns out that doesn't work, that's fine. I'll move on. But I'll keep doing that. I'll keep finding things to push myself into. And I would create. I think this is crucial, right? So the people that generally do really well, it's not enough for you to turn your hours into something for a short time. So what I mean is it's not enough to like exchange your time for money. You've got to be building something bigger. You've got to be building something that endures. So whether it's that you're building a book or Twitter or a podcast series or whatever, you're building something that's bigger than yourself. The wonderful thing about what we create is it adds to the value of us as a person. So if you think about it, your podcast, for example, is like an extension of your value, right? It's something that exists even if you're asleep, and it's creating value that adds to your life. So that's a really remarkable and incredible thing. And if you start doing that when you're 20 and you keep going and building, then by the time you're like 30, 40, whatever, you're getting incredible returns potentially from what you have created, and you can keep creating.
Very detailed answer. Some people will use that $1,000 and break it down by the dollar.
All right. I suppose I could have put it all into Apple stock, but I assumed you were keeping me alive this year rather than...
Yeah, no, it's this year. But what stock would you invest in if I gave you $10,000?
Right now. Right.
Right now. You have to invest today.
Disclaimer, I am an investor in said company, but I put quite a lot into Tesla, and I've done pretty well out of them, but I bought them at the right time, so I've been lucky. I'm a big fan of Elon Musk, and I think I'll tell you what I love about what he did. He looked back when he was starting, and he said, right, what are the three biggest things in the world going to be in the next 50 years? And he said they're going to be clean energy, he said they're going to be electric cars, and they're going to be space travel. So he set up three companies doing just those things, and they're all multi-billion dollar ventures, and I'm pretty sure he's the next Steve Jobs. So I'm saying, you know what, I want my money where he's putting it. So that's what I would invest in.
Yeah, if you were to ask any business guy, like, who are the top CEOs right now, I'm sure everyone would want to say Elon Musk,
yeah,
maybe Bezos, or even Tony Hsieh, episode 18, you guys, from Zappos. And moving on, if you had to read your obituary today, what would it say?
Well, that was over quickly. No. Well,
or is that it?
That was a joke. No, you can run with it if you like. Well, I guess I'd like it to be something like, he went after what excited him most and he brought excitement to others. I like that. Because I think a real key thing in life is chase what excites you. Why would you want to spend your time chasing what bores you? So many people do that. So yeah, I just keep it simple.
Simple is usually best. And as we're coming to a close here, Oliver, do you have any parting piece of guidance for all the listeners today?
I would say life is too precious to waste. It's such a terrible thing to take your time and spend it on stuff you don't enjoy. I like to think of life a bit like a holiday. So imagine you go out on a holiday, right? So you know when you go out on holiday and you've got like 2 weeks and in the first few days you're like, oh my God, this is amazing. I love this. Fantastic. I can do everything I want. But then you get like halfway through your holiday and you start to think, I'm halfway through my holiday. And it's very much like this with life. You can get to a point you're like, oh, I'm halfway through my life. Yikes. And then at some point, you'll be like 2 days away from the end of your holiday. And you're like, oh, I've got to get all this stuff done, right? But I've only got so much time left. I think of life like that. I think it really is. It's a one shot. And a lot of the great stuff is much easier to do at the beginning than it is later on when there's less time and maybe your health isn't on your side. So I just think it's too precious to waste. I encourage everyone listening here to go ahead and seize it.
All right, Oliver. And that will conclude the knowledge round. And I mentioned it earlier in the opening, but you have a novel that you're working on because the internet told you to. Can you go ahead and share with the listeners what that is? I was really interested when I read that.
Okay, so basically about a year ago, I wrote a short story. It was just on a whim. I was helping my girlfriend move at the time. I just entered something on my smartphone. And this post that I'd had in the back of my mind for like 10, 15 years, it went viral. This story went crazy. And within 5 days, I had people from major book publishers and even television and film studios calling me up and asking for the rights to this short story I'd thrown together in an hour on the phone, which is kind of funny.
Can you go ahead and share the story? What was it about?
Very, very briefly, it's the story of a very successful kind of Tony Stark-like figure who, with the best of intentions, thinks he can fix the world and decides he's going to try and end world poverty and save Africa and so forth. But the approach he takes, shall we say, comes with some complications. And I think I'll leave it at that. If you check out my site, you'll find a link to it. It's not very long. It's very easy to digest. But I don't want to spoil the surprise up front. But yeah, so that went very well. And so simply because I had so many people, I mean, literally thousands of people were asking, I had all this interest, I decided I just had to go ahead and write a novel. And I always wanted to. It's been a real learning experience. And I'm hoping it will come out in the middle of next year. But so we'll see how that goes. So that's definitely something I'm working on that's very exciting.
All right. Oliver, what's your vision for the future? What are you currently working on?
My business is currently taking a step backwards to leap forward, which is something I mentioned earlier. Sometimes I think to go the next jump, you need to take a step back, and we're kind of rethinking everything. But we've got some really exciting stuff coming out next year. We're moving to the US and I'm writing a ton of articles, as you know. And this is the first year I've been doing that. And I got 4 million readers. Well, 4 million views, I should say, which is kind of crazy. So I'm thinking that's something I'm going to keep pushing with.
Wow, who knows? Maybe this book of yours coming out in the summer or about that time turns into a movie. Who knows? But you got an exciting future ahead of you, Oliver.
Thank you. So am I. I'm also moderately terrified, but that's part of the journey.
And go ahead and give yourself a plug so all the listeners can get in contact with you.
Okay, well, as you said, my name's Oliver Emberton, and I blog regularly on oliveremberton.com, where you'll find loads of my writing, and you can learn about my forthcoming book. That's it.
All right, Oliver, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you.
All right, guys, that's going to wrap up episode 19. Thank you for listening to the Knowledge for Men podcast show. It's been a pleasure having you be a part of a thriving community of men who want to crush it in all aspects of life.
I'm on a mission here to inspire millions of guys, and with your help, we're going to make a dent in the universe. Check out knowledgeformen.com for a ton of free content that's designed to help you live a remarkable life. Again, that's knowledgeformen.com. I hope to see you there, and always remember, 2014 is the official year of the crush, where we take action to get the life we've always dreamed of. This is your host, Andrew Farabee, and until next time, let's do it.